Hi, I'm Stephen Chu. I'm a professor of psychology here at Stanford University in Birmingham, Alabama. This is the last in a series of videos on the cognitive principles of effective teaching. In this video, I discuss how all the cognitive factors we've considered work together to create a context for teaching and learning. The teacher has to control this context in order to bring about teachable moments. Next, I discuss how formative assessments can be used to create a constructive learning context that will lead to long-term learning. We've now discussed 9 cognitive factors that affect students' ability to learn. Regardless of which pedagogy teachers use, they must consider all these factors. But here's the key thing. They all interact with each other. Changing one factor changes others. Improving one may worsen another. For example, deeper processing helps learning, but it also increases cognitive load, which hurts learning. Activating prior knowledge can help learning if the knowledge is accurate, but if there is a misconception, it can actually hurt learning. In other words, teaching is contextual, a dynamic, complex interplay of multiple factors. The teacher's challenge is to manage this 9-way interaction to bring about learning. In order for learning to occur, the student must encounter new information. And one thing I've not yet discussed is the pedagogical approach to introducing new information. This was intentional because of the contextual nature of teaching. It means that there's no pedagogical magic bullet which will work best for all teachers and all topics and all students. What works for one teacher may not work for another. What works for one student may not work for another. And what works for one class may not work for another class. Now, are some pedagogies more likely to be successful than others? Yes, but every pedagogy has its limitations. There are going to be times when pedagogies which have worked before are not going to be effective. A teacher must constantly adapt and adjust according to student learning. I discussed the cognitive factors of teaching in a framework that cognitive psychologists might use to study them, but that's not the way teachers might use them in the classroom. To address this, let's consider a framework that's better suited for pedagogical practice. It's based on the idea of the teachable moment, which I define as the point at which learning can occur. A teacher's job is to bring about teachable moments and to exploit them fully when they occur. Here's a framework that uses cognitive principles to promote the occurrence of and make the most of teachable moments. There are 5 issues in learning to consider, each of which has multiple parts. Let's discuss each in turn. The first is that students must have an appropriate learning mindset. This covers the issues we discussed in the first video, such as a growth mindset, high self-efficacy, and a sense of trust in the instructor. Students must believe that they belong in the class, that the goals of the class are worth pursuing, and that with proper effort, they can succeed. Students must have effective learning resources. This has to do with both the pedagogy used by the teacher and the cognitive resources on the part of the student, because the two are linked. The teacher needs to present or activate all the relevant information that a student needs to understand a concept, and they must do it using the principles of how people learn. It should build on accurate prior knowledge, be organized to promote chunking and schema development, and it should promote generative thinking about the implications of the information. The student must be fully attentive, devoting mental effort to understanding the topic, relating it to prior knowledge, and reflecting on its implications. Distraction and cognitive overload will undermine learning. Students must be primed for learning. This has to do with metacognitive awareness, prior knowledge, and misconceptions. Students must have the appropriate prior knowledge activated. They must be aware that there is a gap or limitation or misconception in the understanding. They must see the value in correcting that shortcoming. They must be able to recognize when they have achieved a better understanding, but they should also recognize the limitations of this new knowledge. Ideally, being primed to learn means that the students are motivated to use the information after the exam and beyond our classrooms. If the students believe that their knowledge is already sufficient about a topic, or if they're unaware of their level of understanding of a topic, then they're unlikely to learn. Students must use effective learning strategies. Any gain in understanding will only be temporary if students do not use effective learning strategies that lead to long-term retention of the information. The learning strategies should go beyond simply recalling information. They should involve creating schematic knowledge that can direct future learning and reasoning. Students must be primed for transfer of their learning, that is, to use information appropriately and constructively in new situations. This has to do with learning to recognize the relevance and applicability of information in novel situations. Students should understand how experts use the knowledge being taught. We should judge the effectiveness of a teaching method by its ability to bring about teachable moments within the context of these factors. In order to teach effectively, then, the teacher must constantly be aware of the cognitive status of the students And for effective learning, students must constantly be aware of their own beliefs and level of understanding. The best way to do this is through formative assessments. Formative assessments are brief, low-stakes activities that give both the teacher and the student feedback about the student's level of understanding. They're used before summative assessment exams. There are a wide variety of formative assessments, including think, pair, share, predict, observe, explain, muddiest point papers, and so-called clicker questions. They can be adapted to any situation and can be designed to give the teacher and the student whatever kind of feedback is needed. For teachers, they can guide pedagogy, model the desired kind of thinking, help counter misconceptions, and promote transfer of learning. For students, they can improve metacognitive awareness, promote deep processing, and give practice in recalling and applying information in the ways expected by teachers. Formative assessments are critical tools for promoting student learning, regardless of the pedagogy used. Teachable moments make learning possible, but our goal is for students to learn information for the long term. What does it take to make long-term retention possible? Graham Nuttall has studied this question extensively, and he's developed what I call Nuttall's Rule of Three. It says that for long-term learning to occur, a student needed to encounter, on at least three different occasions, the complete set of information she or he needed to understand the concept. There are several key components to this rule. Number one, students must possess all the information needed to understand a concept. If the information is incomplete, either through omission by the teacher or lack of attention by students, then students won't learn. Number two, the information must be encountered on at least three different occasions. One good encounter is not enough. These encounters can be brought about by the teacher in class or the student studying outside of class. Three is a minimum. Complex concepts or concepts where there is a misconception may require more learning experiences. And three, by encounter, Nuttall means that the information must be fully interpreted and integrated into working memory on each occasion. This isn't a superficial experience. Students must be fully attentive and using all available mental effort to understand information and relate it to prior knowledge. The Rule of Three is a useful guideline for developing pedagogy and assignments. It's also useful to students for guiding their learning. In this series, I've tried to give you a comprehensive framework of cognitive factors to help guide your teaching and your pedagogy. I've tried to replace vague concepts like engagement, active learning, and struggle with more refined concepts like attention, deep processing, and cognitive load. We see that teaching presents an enormous challenge far beyond simply presenting information. I hope you found this information useful to you, and I wish you the best in your teaching.